So Shenandoah University, and when I first came in, at Shenandoah, I came in as an adjunct, and they hired me precisely to teach a course that's called Mathematical Thinking, which is a very applied, no, it's not ever, you'll see, it's a math course for non-majors. We have four schools, like conservatory, pharmacy, business school, nurse, a bunch of health professions, and they have this Math 100 course offered to a bunch of, it's a mix of students in the course, and there are many. By our standards, we have 25, 26 students in a class. So it's a large combination, it's a good mix of students from various schools, and they have to do, this is the ultimate course, it's the last course of math they will ever take in their college life as a student. And the course evaluation on the course weren't very good when they hired me. And they said, well, I'm a mathematician, and my research area is in mathematical biology, so I kind of work with MDs. I talk to non-mathematicians. I was talking to non-mathematicians on a daily basis, so they figure out maybe I can find a bridge, you know, find a way to talk to this other, to this sort of other mix of students. So I came in, and since I have my 6 or 7 year now, and I like to call my class Numbers Rock the World, because when I first showed up in that class, when I talked to students, I said, there's no math in my life, give me a break, I have to take this course because it's a requirement and so on, but I don't see math anywhere. I mean, and by the end of 6 or 7 years, I kind of talked, I see students on campus and I say, it's math everywhere. And I don't know how I convince them. So that's why I choose the title, Numbers Rock the World. And it's a classroom viewpoint. So you're basically going to be sitting in the class and experience what they go through, what my students go through in one of my classes. Just a few words. So I will, when I first came in, there was no blended thing in this particular course. The way the course was teaching was pretty much like a traditional math class. You sit in, you do some examples, you run some numbers, you have some results. But apart from everyone presented here, I feel so embarrassed because I had no clue what blended learning means until fall semester when I got an email from somebody in my school about this conference. I said, oh, maybe what I'm doing is kind of a blended thing, so I can go out there and talk about it, because I looked over the repository online, which I love, by the way, and I said, there's not so much math, so maybe I can go out there and, you know, convince them you can do some blended things in math. And actually, we do something in stats classes as well, in other classes, but I will concentrate on my, this non-major math course. So I'm going to just infuse, so it's blended learning infused in my class. I didn't plan this ahead. I didn't have a program. I didn't sit down and think for a year before teaching this class. It's all organically born blended learning in my course. So the title of the course in the catalog is Mathematical Thinking, so it's not new math tools or learn new equations or complex analysis or anything. Thinking. So I have students come in the class and thinking, kind of concerned that what do we do in this class? We just sit around and think about math? Because we kind of want to do that sort of thing. So we try to understand, we want to think mathematically, try to analyze everyday questions, and try to maybe, you know, sit down and solve them with some mathematical tools they already have. The level of math they need to be in this class is adding number, algebra and geometry. Very basic algebra and geometry. Maybe some sort of exponentials where you deal with money, but that's all they need to go for my class. So this is the level, and I put it out in the syllabus. Like, at the beginning it wasn't in the syllabus. It was just a traditional sort of syllabus and description. But then, over the time, I have the course is a combination of lecture, class discussion, and active experiential learning. And that means, when you show up my class, you're not going to just sit there for 50 minutes or 1 hour and 50 minutes listening to whatever, and then type something, go home, take a nap, do homework. You're going to have this in-class project, you're going to have take-home project, you're going to have to write things. They usually don't write things in math classes, and you're going to have to work in teams. And that was another surprising one, because I have students, I never have to work in teams in a math class. I mean, what kind of a, you know, environment is that? So this comes up in the syllabus. They know up front what they should expect, and I'm very keen on that. On the first day of class, I enforce that a lot. Now the question comes, it seems like a normal traditional math class, but how am I going to get a grade on this? So that's the first question I kind of receive. So how's my grade going to be affected by this non-traditional class? And I say, well, In my class, you're gonna have 10% meaning like a letter grade in the end, so they have to do some writing. Actually, they will do a lot of writing. They do entry essays, and in the, I'll go through these assignments. As I said, you're gonna sit in my class and go through the whole semester with me. That they have some essays, they have these project presentations and creative homework and quizzes, and they are all creative. It's not, I mean, we used to have a textbook, and I used to use the textbook for the first year or so, but then I gave up completely. And all the homework and quizzes are very local, creative, student-based homeworks. Like, we take a map, university map, we take the city neighborhood maps, we work with neighborhood information, so everything is very personalized. Okay, so this is how I like to present my course and the things that I'm doing in this course. And I call it blended. And I probably didn't notice the little circles, the little spheres, they blend into each other. And I keep putting in all the slides because it's not really blending. They're kind of separate, you see, like they're not really infusing each other, but they're kind of separate, but they live in a big bubble. So this is how I see my course as well. I see a bunch of things that we do in the class. And they all, color you map. So the first class, my students show up in the first class. I told you, a conservatory, a bunch of mix of students, conservatory, nursing, history, criminal justice, a bunch of things they don't, I mean, they're there because they don't like math. They will be in another course. So the first class, the first thing we do in class, I present them a bunch of modules. So I say, this is a class about thinking mathematically. I want you guys to think algorithmically. How do you actually, if you want to be successful as an artist, as a criminal justice, as a businessman, or whatever your goal is, you really have to look at people and figure out what sets them up, what picks them up from the crowd. It's like thinking. It's not just, I know we like to do, say, critical thinking, but in my view, it's just thinking, because they don't think that much. So I say, you want to explore all this thinking in various, because you think it's not so much thinking going on in, I don't know, driving a car or looking at art or paying your bills. So I'm going to try to convince you there's a lot of thinking and a bunch of things you don't even think about. And they go through a bunch of modules, and I say, well, this class is built up on 12 modules. But guess what? I'm going to teach you only the modules that you guys like the most. So they get a chance to vote on what part of the course or modules of the course they like the most. And I'm very flexible. I built up my course according to their votes, results of their votes. So the first class activity, it's a vote. I'm going to go back to this poster, big poster. So these are all the choices. And I'm going to go through, and I was planning to do it in live, in class here, voting, but it might take a while, so I'll just. But they vote, they kind of, it's pretty hard to vote on all 12, so I broke it in. I grouped it in four groups, so they have to vote on social choices, where we talk about voting power, sharing, apportionment, management science, where we talk about getting around, all sorts of graphs, touring. There, you know, they have a business, a show company, and they want to tour around. How do you come up with the best tour? Networks, scheduling, and then we have an artistic part of the book, the course I call it, where we talk about spirals, symmetry, fractals. That's one of my favorites. And money, it's in there because it's about growth and form. That's the tricky one because they usually vote art first, right? It's a bunch of conservatory students in there, but they get to do the money right up front, so it's a tricky one. So they get to, I kind of go through each chapter and I kind of explain with a real life example. I have a slide, then include it here because it might take a while. I have a bunch of slides for each. Presenting each chapter, and that's done with Google Forms, by the way. They vote on this, they look at the, they collect the votes. We actually do only class voting. Each of them receives a ballot. Somebody collects the ballot, we put all the votes on the board, we count the votes, we decide, oh, so who the winner is? I mean, what's the ranking? What am I going to teach you first on the second day of class? And they have to learn voting in the process, right? And doing so, they have to use Google Forms to collect the votes. They have to use Google Sheets to work with the votes because they are larger table, they have to make them smaller, there are some tools in there. They have to use Excel to put in the methods and figure out who the winner is. And now I just learned about poll everywhere, which might be a little bit simpler to just collect numbers and put them in the sheets or in the Excel. So they, from the first day of class, they're using all this stuff, and I mean, they loved it, because the second day of class, they have to submit in the so-called entry essay. So they have to do their first writing. And when they do that, they have, I mean, we go through the writing center requirements. It has to be done long with so many words, all the structure of an essay and things. But they have to be, it has to be an essay about math. How do you feel about math? How did they feel in the past? Did they have a teacher they hated? Did they like it? Were they good in elementary, but they hated in high school? What changed? They have their aunt is doing taxes. I mean, anything that's math. You know, what's their feeling about math? And usually it's whatever you see here in red. Math was never my thing. I have math. Why do I need to learn this? I need this class. I'll give you a chance. There's no math in my life. That's also connected to something else. And I collect all this essay. I can write a book by now, by 7 years in. And they are really not very math friendly, let's put it that way. So this is this essay is due the second class. So it's a very early introduction. I mean, what's your major? You know, I collect all this information and I kind of know what class am I, what sort of people I have to deal with. I like to know that. And the next day, I'm gonna give them a chance. So let's vote on. Usually, it's a very good timing as the class builds. It's like right around if it's spring semester with the Academy Awards. You know, we can get on the vote movies. Or if it's fall, we can. Yeah, there are a bunch of things we can vote on. And I say, let's run this again. And they're like, oh no, it takes so long to vote and collect the votes and put them in. And so I said, oh, let's make up some numbers then. You know, or they use all these online tools that would really collect all the votes. So they say, oh, I'm going to use those online things because it's so much easier than doing it in class. So I kind of enforce it on them to use technology. Oh, my students in this particular class, they don't really know what Excel is. I mean, they have to figure out how to use Excel and where is it on the, I mean, it comes up with all the lectures provided by the university, but they never use it. So it's a very, it's quite an impact on them. So we go for the first class and the second class. Now, entry essays in, and by the way, the entry essays, their first introduction in using, most of them are, half of the class is freshmen. So they don't really use Canvas or Blackboard before, and I usually, the entry essays, I don't do paperwork. Everything has to be online submission. If they write it on paper, they have to take a picture and send it to me. So I do not collect any papers in my class. So now they kind of got used to using, I put them on Blackboard, I put them in Google form. I said, whatever works for you, just submit it online, you know, make sure you learn how to use this stuff. So yeah, that's the first assessment. We jump into the chapters based on what they voted on, but like sort of before spring break or winter break or whatever it is, whatever break comes in, they have to do something else for their class. And that's called in-class project presentations. In-class project presentation is basically, simply put, you have to talk 5 to 10 minutes or present or produce something, you know, to convince me or convince people in the audience or inform us of something that's mathematical in your life. It could be that your brother likes number or your dog likes a TV show based on numbers, or that you have a passion that involves math. And this is what I get from that. There's no math in my life. That's it. And I'm not going to find anything. I sit around, talk to them. They'll figure it out. They'll find something. But again, it just turns out that the way the semester arrangement, like usually if it's a spring break, we have a snow day. Or if it's a fall break, if it's a fall semester, we have a rainy day, like a hurricane or something in this area. So another assessment usually comes up, or if I go to a conference and I send them this assignment, it's called the snow day assignment. So I'll jump ahead a little bit. I call it the rainy snow day news assignment. They are supposed to go online and read a report on 5 math-related news. Online, it could be anything, a blog, it could be any sort of online resource they can find out. They have to do this reporting, you know, each news, 5 news, the title, what do they read about, why is it math related, just explain in a few words. I mean, I kind of give them all the details, how many words, how long, how detailed. We have a graded rubric for that. And they have to submit everything again online. When they do that, they will figure out there's some map in their lives. Based on what they're reading, they will connect, you know what I mean? Like what you're reading, it's how they keep saying, the six people you talk with, it's like the average, you are the average of the six people. The same here, I figure out 5 Muse is a good number. So 5 Muse you're reading, it's your average of, you'll find some math in there. It's usually sports or diseases when they fall out or, you know. But it's so amazing because I have 50 students in all in 2 sections. And when they report on 5 times 5, 50 students, 250 Muse, they never, I mean, I barely get overlaps. So it's really amazing, like how spread their interests are, and there's always some math connections, some numbers in there. So that helps them a lot with their projects, right? They do this in-class project presentations, and they have to be in class, they have to stand in there and talk to us, like, you know, the presentation skills and things. And that involves a lot, it just turned out, involves a lot of technology. Some of them do iMovies, like the dancers. They show me some moves and how the math is involved in their dance technique. YouTube, PowerPoint, Prezi. We use AirView and AirPlay to, you know, go on the big screen from the laptops if they use some technology. We do have some people do panel discussions, like the musician brought in the instruments and they show us how different mouthpieces, different sizes for the mouthpieces for, I don't know, different instruments, and how math is involved in that. So there are a bunch of, and some of them do workshops. They run a whole class workshop. So they can do anything between 5 or 15 or 50 minutes even. So it really involves a lot of using technology. And they get very, like at the beginning they're, oh, I don't really know how to do that, but they have time. They have like a month to present, to prepare and present this project. And because we have the conservatory students in, and they're more like outgoing, and they like, you know, they don't have, they go first usually, and all the other students, they kind of form like, they know each other after a while, so they don't, they feel comfortable presenting about themselves. And the range of presentations, oh my God. They talk about Renaissance art, soccer, healthcare, cooking, history of mathematics, voice, origami, golden ratio, 3D printing, math tricks, orchestral setup, shop math, history, GPS history, choreography, paychecks, poetry, mathematics in the Bible. It's possible to shatter a glass using your own voice, coffee, graphics. I mean, it's like everywhere. Sports, a lot of sports. So it really covers, oh, theater, Sophie Germain and Primes, video games, you name it, how animals get their spots. So whatever their interests are, oh, I had a student, her father worked in the military, in the army, and was a sniper. So she talked about math and, you know, how much math you need to be a good sniper. It was a bad time during the American Sniper movie, but anyway. But there was that math part in her life. So they go from, remember the entry essays with no math in my life, and I really don't see math anywhere. We have the project presentation, we have the entry essays, and then we go through each of these chapters. So I talked about the creative homework, so let me get to that point. I really have to show you how those. So the creative adaptive homeworks, whatever the topic is, let's say we do power, meaning how much power a CEO has in a board. I mean, you have a board of people running a particular business, who has the most power based on the votes in the board. And they don't really care about that because nobody's running a business now, right? But I say, well, how about you guys think, most of you are, in 4 years from now, you might want to go and dance on Broadway or whatever. You might not do that, but maybe you have a little bit of money and you put together a small company and you put that much money, each of you. And based on how much money you put, you have so many votes. Because, you know, friendship is great, but when it comes down, should we open a new office? Should we hire a new person? People argue. So companies work, they have small prints, and they have, you know, these lawyers come in and they give you some number of votes based on the shares you have in a small enterprise, a small business. And who's the most powerful then? You know, based on the numbers, you can't really say. And then we go through the numbers and they learn methods this way, on one, and then they work in teams. You know, I say, well, now you form, there's a lot of teamwork in my class, in my classroom. And online maths, oh, we have this chapters on graphs and networks and Turing. Like, let's say you want to visit a bunch of cities in Europe, and you don't know which one to go first, or which one, you know, there are boats or airplanes or trains to go from place to place. Can you come up with the best tool possible so you don't spend much money or whatever, time, or depending if they're short on time, you can minimize time. If you're short on money, you can minimize money and so on. They also do, the one that I just did one project by mistake, because I had to prepare a test on all these management chapters, like the networks, and, graphs, Turing, and I didn't have time to prepare the test, so I showed up in class the test day and I said, you know what, I don't have a test, but guess what, driving in, because I drive like an hour to work, I came up with this brilliant idea. You guys are going to create a test, you're going to split in groups, and you're going to create a fully fledged test for these three chapters. They look at me, yeah, interesting. And then they realize to create a test, they have to know the material well. Oh, and they have to provide the keys. And to provide the keys, they have to know the material even better. And they have to produce the test in a format like, you know, the handout sheet or the online thing. Because I didn't mention, but most of my quizzes are on Blackboard, no paper. Remember, I'm a no paper person. So everything is online. So they have to produce the test online. And the deal is, I have five groups doing five tests. I'm going to switch them, you know, with my other section. They're going to receive the test from the other groups. So any issues I get, I'm going to send them to them. So they have to be, you know, good produced tests with good produced keys, so there are no issues. They love this process. It took me longer, because I had to grade more tests than I was supposed to. And you'll see they have exit essays. Everybody said they love this. In the exit essays. Actually, they proposed they might want to teach a whole module to me. They said, how about we choose a module as a team and we teach it to the whole class? I said, well, that's a cool idea. You know, I can do it next semester. So this is the sort of creative adaptive homeworks. When we do maps, we work with maps from Shenandoah University. When we do class examples, we do class examples from, you know, their whatever their majors are, or whatever they interest them. So it's all, everything very personalized. And they kind of liked it. Teamwork, they always like that. When they work in teams and they have times to work on projects, sometimes it's in class, sometimes it's a take home. They go online and they chat and they figure out a way to come up with the final product. I'm quite happy. I'm not interested in the whatever goes behind the doors, but they get the job done. And they use all this sort of IT, you know, techniques. One more thing. This is what I get in their exit essays. Oh, math is not that scary. Or I never know that math could have more than the just numbers. I thought it's just addition, subtraction, all that. It makes more sense now. Those real applications, they really love the projects. And the projects take time, right? Sometimes they take longer, and it takes time out of my teaching time, and I kind of figure, at some point I thought I'll drop off the projects. You know, I'll do something that they don't have to present in class, they just have to hand it to me and I'll grade them. But then it turns out they love the project time. They said, well, I can't wait to come to class and just listen to the other guy, see what's mathematical in his life. So they were very excited about that. I said, the project presentation was a fantastic idea and one of my favorite parts in the class. So it was really interesting to see different points of view of my peers. And I learned that math can relate to almost anything. So they keep telling me when I meet them on campus, you know what, I really kind of turn around and I see math in so many other places that I haven't seen them before. And I think this is the key of the course, is my method of thinking. We want to make them think about where math is and how math can help you to get your thing. Because one thing we keep hearing about this course, I don't need it. It's not related to my major. You know, it's not going to help me in any way. It's not that they see math everywhere, but it's the way that what I'm interested in is they see a way to deal with things mathematically. You know, I take it, or I organize it, I take step one, step two, step three, it's going to get done, no matter what your job is. So I still get some things like, well, I like it, but I'm not going to use it ever. You still get some of those, but people are quite excited in the end. So it's kind of from zero to one, in my opinion. It's been a very, I mean, I love teaching this course. And you see those the exit essays. Again, I like to write a book, perspective in reentry essay and perspective at the exit essay. It's really very different. And they keep saying, I was never told that in elementary or middle school or high school. I was never, things were never presented that way. So I think maybe us as educators, I think we played a big role in bringing kids in and liking, not just math, I guess it's about anything, any discipline you teach. If you teach it in a way that they will be excited about. Now, I do have a slide on, I put together all the IT resources we used for the class, and this is very unusual. Think about your math class, right? I don't think you use so many things in one of your math classes. And this is not really, as I keep saying, it's not really a math class, right? A mathematical thinking class. But I'm sure even for a mathematical thinking class, you wouldn't have thought you're going to use all those things, right? So it turns out that it's a blended class, and I'm quite proud of it, and I'm trying to improve it. When I try to improve it, I'm basing my next steps on the entry and exit essays, and I like this particular, the good, the bad, and the ugly of the things I learned. So the good students really like it, they're really into it, they don't slip in the class. If there's a slipping student, you walk around and, you know, having teams, you have the chance to talk to the ones that are really dragging or not doing anything. The academic success, they have good grades, course evaluations are high. Self-assessment, they really like the fact that they work in groups and they learn more or they improve themselves. They keep saying, I just learned by talking to my other friends, which they don't usually do in a math class, a traditional math class, or even in other classes. Personalized learning, if somebody's really dragging behind, you give him a chance, you know how to build it up, you know, you want to help him get a good grade and you build up the project that way. They just love it, as I said. Now the bad. Well, they complain. Some people still complain about using Google Drives. It makes them crazy. They don't know how to do it. There's a way to see how many students and when is the last time they logged in Blackboard. Some they never logged in Blackboard. And they're not necessarily the freshmen. The passive student issue, right? Some people might rely on better students to produce homeworks. Grading difficulties. I think people mentioned that before, so I'm not going to stay on that. Meaningful use of internet resources. I think this is where this is what I'm done. So you really have to make sure they know what to use and how to use and what's right and what's bad. And ugly, it's very time consuming on my side. I spent way too much time on this course, preparing this course, than I would have otherwise. So I picked up a bunch of examples from presentations before. I'm more welcome to any other things suggested we might have to improve a math course. So thank you for your time, and I'll take questions.
So we're right at time. You guys can, we've got 15 minutes before the mixer starts, so you can ask some questions if people want to ask questions, or we can just say, hey, go grab people at the mixer.
Yeah, we can grab the mixer, I guess.
That's on the mixer, yeah, I'm seeing nods, so. Okay. All right, great, thank you guys. Thank you, yeah, it's in the big room. It's like rain, so we decided not to stop it outside.